Recorded books and one-click digital present Better Living Through Criticism: How to Think About Art, Beauty, and Truth by A.O. Scott. Narrated by Jonathan Todd Ross. Introduction. What is criticism? A preliminary dialogue. Question. What's the point of criticism? What are critics good for? Answer. Those are the big questions. The obvious questions, anyway. But they're not exactly the same question. But isn't criticism just whatever critics do? Sure. And everybody who criticizes is a critic. You see the problem. We've barely gotten started, and already we're running in circles. When we talk about criticism, are we talking about a job? A kind of writing, a species of journalism or scholarship, an intellectual discipline of some sort, and therefore the people who make their livings at it? Or are we talking about a less specialized undertaking, something like playing cards or cooking or riding a bicycle, something anyone can learn to do? Or maybe even a more elementary, more reflexive activity, like dreaming or breathing or crying? I thought the arrangement was that I would be asking the questions here. Sorry. So let's start again, and start with you. You are a professional critic, and also someone who thinks a lot about what criticism is and what it's for. Though not necessarily in that order. And not exclusively, of course. Okay, but what I'm asking is, what good am I? What's the point of what I do? If you want to put it that way, I might not have been quite so hostile. No worries. Opposition is true friendship, as William Blake said. Every critic grows accustomed to dealing with skepticism and suspicion and sometimes outright contempt. How dare you? What gives you the right? Why should anyone listen to you? We get this all the time. Provoking people to question our competence, our intelligence, our very right to exist, that seems to be a big part of what it is to be a critic. And now you've decided to fight back. You're feeling defensive. Would it be accurate to say that you wrote this whole book to settle a score with Samuel L. Jackson? Not exactly. But I'm glad you brought that up. A bit of background. In May 2012, on the day the Avengers, you saw it, right? Everyone did, was released on 3,500 screens across North America, I published a review in which I praised some aspects of the movie. The cleverness of its dialogue, the sharpness of the performances, while complaining about others. In particular, its sacrifice of originality on the altar of blockbuster conformity. If you'll allow me to quote myself, the secret of the Avengers is that it is a snappy little dialogue comedy dressed up as something else, that something else being a giant ATM for Marvel and its new studio overlords, the Walt Disney Company. That assessment stands up pretty well, if I say so myself. By the time Avengers: Age of Ultron came along a few years later, everyone else seemed to be saying more or less the same thing, that its charms and thrills were overwhelmed by soulless corporate spectacle. There is some satisfaction in having been in the vanguard of pointing out the obvious. At the time, though, I was part of a premature backlash. Not long after my review was posted on the New York Times website, Jackson, who plays Nick Fury in the movie and in other Marvel Universe franchise installments, posted a Twitter message exhorting hashtag Avengers fans that A.O. Scott needs a new job. Let's help him find one. One he can actually do. Scores of his followers heeded his call, not by demanding that my editors fire me, but in the best Twitter tradition, by retweeting Jackson's outburst and adding their own vivid suggestions about what I was qualified to do with myself. The more coherent tweets expressed familiar, you might even say canonical, anti-critical sentiments, that I had no capacity for joy, that I wanted to ruin everyone else's fun, that I was a hater, a square, and a snob, even, and this was kind of a new one, that the nerdy kid in middle school who everybody picked on because he didn't like comic books had grown up to be me. In my day, some of the nerdy kids everybody picked on were the ones who did like comic books. But I guess things have changed now that the superheroes and their fanboy followers have taken over everything. I was picked on for reasons that had nothing to do with comic books. The Avengers incident blew up into one of those absurd and hyperactive internet squalls that are now a fixture of our cultural life. Mace Windu had called me out. I had summoned the righteous wrath of Jules Winfield. Jackson and I were photoshopped into action movie combat poses on entertainment websites. Miniature think pieces sprouted like mushrooms after a rainstorm. Our Twitter beef made the news in Brazil, Germany, and Japan. A few of my colleagues embraced the cause of standing up not only for my own beleaguered self, but also for the integrity and importance of the job I was, in Jackson's view, unqualified to do. Were you scared? On the contrary, I was grateful. Neither my person nor my livelihood was in any danger, and The Avengers went on to become the second fastest film to date to reach $1 billion at the global box office. I gained a few hundred followers on Twitter and became, for a few minutes, both a hissable villain and a make-believe martyr for a noble and much maligned cause. It was win-win all around, and then everyone moved on. But even a tempest in a teapot can have meteorological significance, and I think Jackson raised a valid and vital question. Putting aside the merits or limitations of what I wrote about The Avengers, or any other movie, it's always worth asking just what the job of the critic is, and how it might actually be done. So you've set out here to defend the job against the attacks, the criticism, of sensitive movie stars and their fans? Isn't that a little bit hypocritical? It seems like you can dish it out, but you can't take it. Well, no, actually. I mean, yes, we all get a little sensitive when the people whose work we write about, or for that matter, our readers, find fault with what we do. That's only human. What I'm more interested in here is the general tendency, I would really say the universal capacity of our species, to find fault. And also to bestow praise. To judge. That's the bedrock of criticism. How do we know or think we know what's good or bad, what's worth attacking or defending or telling our friends about? How do we assess the success or failure of the Avengers or anything else? Because whether or not it's our job, we do judge. We can't help it. And how do we judge? Or maybe the question is, why do we judge? Honestly, when I set out to write this book, I thought the answers would come much more easily than they did. That there would in fact be answers of a kind I could state clearly and emphatically. Maybe I'd discover that we know what's beautiful or meaningful or even just fun because of neural switches or hormonal responses that evolved at the dawn of human time in order to help us avoid predators and produce more offspring. Or maybe I'd conclude that we are able to make determinations and discriminations of value because we have access to innate and eternal standards that, though they mutate over the centuries and express themselves differently from place to place, nonetheless keep us on the path of truth and beauty. You can look at the history of human creativity and find patterns, shapes, sounds, stories, that suggest deep continuity. You can also survey the wild diversity of human making and conclude that no single category or set of criteria could possibly contain it all. Every culture, every class and tribe and coterie, every period in history has developed its own canons of craft and invention. Our modern cosmopolitan sensibilities graze among the objects they have left behind, sampling and comparing and carrying out the pleasant work of sorting and assimilating what we find. Meanwhile, we are inundated with new stuff, which is also pleasant, even if the glut can leave us feeling paralyzed and empty. We marvel at the abundance or worry about the too muchness of it all. There are so many demands on our attention, so many offers of diversion and enlightenment on the table, that choosing among them can feel like serious work. And that work, the winnowing and contrasting, the measuring and interpreting, is what you call criticism? Yes, but it's also something more basic and more urgent. It's complicated. Let me go back to Samuel L. Jackson. 6 months after the Avengers episode, he revisited our Twitter quarrel in an interview with the Huffington Post and gave voice to a widespread complaint about criticism in general, and about the criticism of popular culture in particular. 99% of the people in the world look at that movie as what it is, he said. It's not an intellectual exposition that you have to intellectualize in any way. This is an old and powerful, in some ways an unanswerable, argument against criticism, rooted in the ideas that creative work should be taken on its own terms, and that thought is the enemy of experience. And it is indeed precisely the job of the critic to disagree, to refuse to look at anything simply as what it is, to insist on subjecting it to intellectual scrutiny. Intellectualize is a deliberately ugly word, the use of which is an accusation in its own right. But really, it's just a synonym for think. And it's worth asking why it should be necessary to deny so strenuously that the Avengers might be both the product and a potential object of thought. The movie is very much an intellectual exposition, in the general sense of having arisen from the conscious intentions and active intelligence of its creators, including Jackson himself. It also, like many other comic book entertainments, sets out to explore what fans of the genre and veterans of high school English would be sure to recognize as big themes, among them honor, friendship, revenge, and the problem of evil in a lawful universe. And finally, and from my own perspective most vexingly, The Avengers shows what can happen when a playful storytelling instinct collides with the imperative of global profit that drives so much 21st century Hollywood production. All of which is to say that The Avengers is an extremely interesting and complex artifact, and that its successes and limitations are worth puzzling over. And yet, even to contemplate the work of teasing out the good from the bad, finding the context and staking a claim, might be to miss the point. Or, as Jackson put it, if you say something that's fucked up about a piece of bullshit pop culture that really is good, The Avengers is a fucking great movie. Joss Whedon did an awesome job. If you don't get it, then just say, I don't get it. But I get it. In particular, I appreciate the double standard that Jackson invokes as he places The Avengers simultaneously beneath criticism, a piece of bullshit pop culture, and beyond it, a fucking great movie. He is echoing the reflexive disdain for movies and other low and middlebrow amusements that came so easily to intellectuals of an earlier era, and at the same time, invoking the ancient, super highbrow idea that a work of art is inviolate and sufficient unto itself. In these circumstances, a critic will be guilty of foolishly taking seriously what was only ever meant as harmless, easy fun, or else of dragging something sublime down to his own ridiculous level. But guilty either way. Here's the important thing, though. In doing this, a critic will be no different from anyone else who stops to think about the experience of watching The Avengers, or reading a novel, or beholding a painting, or listening to a piece of music. Because that thinking is where criticism begins. We're all guilty of it. Or at least we should be. So you've written a book in defense of thinking? Where's the argument? Nobody is really against thinking. Are you serious? Anti-intellectualism is virtually our civic religion. Critical thinking may be a ubiquitous educational slogan, a vaguely defined skill we hope our children pick up on the way to adulthood, but the rewards for not using your intelligence are immediate and abundant. As consumers of culture, we are lulled into passivity, or at best, prodded toward a state of pseudo-semi-self-awareness, encouraged toward either the defensive group identity of fanhood or a shallow, half-ironic eclecticism. Meanwhile, as citizens of the political commonwealth, We are conscripted into a polarized climate of ideological belligerence in which bluster too often substitutes for argument. There is no room for doubt and little time for reflection as we find ourselves buffeted by a barrage of sensations and a flood of opinion. We can fantasize about slowing down or opting out, but ultimately we must learn to live in the world as we find it, and to see it as clearly as we can. This is no simple task. It is easier to seek out the comforts of groupthink, prejudice, and ignorance. Resisting those temptations requires vigilance, discipline, and curiosity. So then what you've written is a manifesto against laziness and stupidity? You could put it that way. But why cast it in such a negative light? This book is also, I hope, a celebration of art and imagination, an examination of our inborn drive to cultivate delight, and of the various ways we refine that impulse. And all that is the critic's job? It's everyone's job, and I believe it's a job we can actually do. I suggest that the effort might begin with the way we address the works that answer our bottomless hunger for meaning and pleasure, and also, simultaneously, with the way we understand our responses to those beautiful, baffling things. We are far too inclined to regard art as an ornament and to perceive taste as a fixed, narrow track along which each one of us travels, alone or in select, like-minded company. Alternatively, we seek to subordinate the creative, pleasurable aspects of our lives to supposedly more consequential matters, pushing the aesthetic dimensions of existence into the boxes that hold our religious beliefs, political dogmas, or moral assumptions. We trivialize art. We venerate nonsense. We can't see past our own bullshit. Enough of that. It's the job of art to free our minds, and the task of criticism to figure out what to do with that freedom. That everyone is a critic means, or should mean, that we are each of us capable of thinking against our own prejudices, of balancing skepticism with open-mindedness, of sharpening our dulled and glutted senses and battling the intellectual inertia that surrounds us. We need to put our remarkable minds to use and to pay our own experience the honor of taking it seriously. Okay, fine. But how? Good question. Chapter 1. The Critic as Artist, and Vice Versa. What is a critic? If you ask around, or read some of my mail, you will learn that a critic is, above all, a failed artist, unloading long-simmering, envious resentments on those who had the luck, talent, or discipline to succeed. This assumption is so widespread as to amount to an article of public faith. Every working critic could easily assemble, from discarded letters and deleted emails, a suite of variations on the themes of, "You're just jealous," and "I'd like to see you do better." In response, it can always be noted, immodestly and therefore not always persuasively, that history provides empirical, biographical evidence to the contrary. An extensive roster of important critics who are also masters of various arts. In the mid-19th century, Charles Baudelaire wrote brilliantly about modern painting without harming either his skills or his standing as a poet. In the second half of the 20th, John Ashbery and Frank O'Hara did the same. Philip Larkin, another poet, wrote ardently and insightfully, albeit with a touch of his habitual grumpiness, about jazz. Hector Berlioz was a preeminent music critic as well as a great composer. George Bernard Shaw was both one of the greatest English-language drama critics and one of the greatest English-language dramatists of his time. Le Corbusier's writings about architecture have been at least as influential as his buildings, and are perhaps more accommodating. The key directors of the French New Wave, Jean-Luc Godard, Eric Rohmer, Claude Chabrol, François Truffaut, started out as film critics, associated with the journal Cahiers du Cinéma, Most of the significant critics of poetry since at least the Romantic era have also been poets. And a few, Samuel Taylor Coleridge, T.S. Eliot, have attained canonical stature in both forms. So there! But the defensive critic may be compelled to admit that such figures are outliers, exceptions that prove a deeply embedded rule. The rule is upheld by the obvious and apparently immutable hierarchical distinction between what critics and artists do. One person may do both, but there is little doubt about where the real value, the real work, resides. The novels are okay, but it's the book reviews that really stand out. Is it possible to imagine fainter, more damning praise? The writers and poets of whom this can be said belong mostly to the ranks of the minor and the almost memorable, providing thesis fodder for intrepid graduate students and waiting in the shadows with gray, stoical patience for a moment of reassessment and rediscovery. The number of critics who have managed to last, to claim, on the basis of their critical writing alone, a foothold on Parnassus or a spot in the canon, is vanishingly small. This is no doubt because criticism is understood to be a time-bound, reactive, secondary activity, stealing whatever temporary prestige, importance, or shock value it has from the durable labor of real artists. As their art persists beyond the difficult moment of its birth, it leaves behind not only the original responses it provoked, but also the world that spawned those responses. Moving toward its future, from the church altar to the museum, from the bookseller's stall to the classroom, from the concert hall to the recording studio, from the rundown Times Square grindhouse to the Criterion Collection DVD box, from the ragged domain of physical artifacts to the seamless digital archive, the work acquires new admirers, fresh skeptics, and calls forth interpretations that discern previously unsuspected meanings and pleasures within its familiar contours. Art, in other words, is durable and also mutable, whereas criticism is fixed and therefore perishable. The job of criticism is to be about art. The job of art is just to be. Criticism, in this view, is, at best, helpful and disposable, an inessential, changeable prop, like the temporary partition in the gallery on which a painting is hung, or the cover slapped on a paperback edition of a classic book. Useful, perhaps, but basically superfluous. And it is always a small step from recognizing that we can live without criticism to deciding that we should. In the opening pages of Real Presences, his study of the unacknowledged intimations of divinity in secular culture, George Steiner envisions a utopia, a counter-Platonic republic in which all talk about the arts, music, and literature is prohibited, and from which the reviewer and the critic have been banished. That Steiner is himself a critic of considerable renown is not a sign of bad faith, but rather of idealism, of a determination at least to imagine a cultural situation unburdened by the dominance of the secondary and the parasitic that defines our unhappy present condition. Steiner's attack on criticism is a defense of art. This is not a matter of taking up arms against individual critics who spitefully or callously wound the feelings of particular artists, but of a more profound antagonism, the response to a more systemic threat of harm. In Steiner's view, and in the view of many others who share his prejudices, even if they lack his learning, criticism is a pernicious, parasitic growth on the mighty trunk of human creativity. At least in the fantasies of anti-critical ideologues, who are often professional critics themselves, the glories of creation can only be apprehended if those distorting excrescences are cleared away. It is a mortal, existential struggle. If art is to live, criticism must die. But exactly the opposite is true. It is my contention here that criticism, far from sapping the vitality of art, is instead what supplies its lifeblood. That criticism, properly understood, is not an enemy from which art must be defended, but rather another name, the proper name, for the defense of art itself. Let me go further. Criticism is art's late-born twin. They draw strength and identity from a single source, even if, like most siblings, their mutual dependency is frequently cloaked in rivalry and suspicion. Will it sound defensive or pretentious if I say that criticism is an art in its own right? Not in the narrow quotidian sense in which art is more or less synonymous with skill, but in the grand, fully exalted, romantic meaning of the word. That the critic is a craftsman of sorts is obvious enough. I want to insist that the critic is also a creator. And if my own workmanlike efforts are inadequate to support the assertion, because, look, I was on a deadline and the editor cut the best parts and nobody understands me anyway, let me fall back temporarily on an argument from authority. H.L. Mencken, the sage of Baltimore and the scourge of all that was phony and flabby in American culture in the first half of the 20th century, declared that any good critic was acting not from the motive of the pedagogue, but the motive of the artist. Rebutting the popular misconception that the critic writes because he is possessed by a passion to advance enlightenment, to put down error and wrong, to disseminate some specific doctrine, in short, to make arguments, he proposed a much more basic impulse. What motivates the critic is no more and no less than the simple desire to function freely and beautifully, to give outward and objective form to ideas that bubble inwardly and have a fascinating lure in them, to get rid of them dramatically and make an articulate noise in the world. Exactly! This blithe assertion of intellectual and creative autonomy, supported by the bravura and insight of which Mencken at his best was capable, and by the permanent spot he managed to claim in the American literary pantheon, is complicated by the nature of the particular art form Mencken's notional critic pursues. The contradictory heart of the matter is that criticism is an art produced in reference to, and therefore in conflict with, other arts. T.S. Eliot, who did not hesitate to associate criticism with the other fine arts, also noted its exceptional status, its essential difference from its siblings. He liked to describe art, in particular poetry, which he favored not only for vocational reasons, but also in deference to its traditional position of supremacy in Western aesthetics, as autotelic, meaning self-completing or self-sufficient. A poem, a statue, or a piece of music is essentially, supposedly, independent, freestanding, whereas any specimen of the art of criticism, however dazzling in itself, must always lean upon and make reference to something else. This makes criticism an anomaly. It may be true that art is born of a struggle with the hard facts of life and the obduracy of the materials at hand, but this struggle does not really involve personal mutual hostility. The sculptor is not the enemy of stone. The painter is not in competition with the human form. The key of G will not take umbrage at a composer's use of it. Words do not hate poets. But criticism, as Mencken notes, is different, in part because it is, or seems, personal. When the critic sits down to compose his criticism, his artist ceases to be a friend and becomes mere raw material for his work of art. It is my experience that artists invariably resent this cavalier use of them. They are pleased so long as the critic confines himself to the modest business of interpreting them, preferably in terms of their own estimate of themselves, but the moment he proceeds to adorn their theme with variations of his own, the moment he brings new ideas to the enterprise and begins contrasting them with their ideas, that moment they grow restive. It is precisely at this point, of course, that criticism becomes genuine criticism. Before that, it was mere reviewing. When a critic passes it, he loses his friends. By becoming an artist, he becomes the foe of all other artists. Mencken's conclusion is that this state of hostilities is ultimately beneficial to all concerned. Literature always thrives best, in fact, in an atmosphere of hearty strife. Agreed. And so do all the other arts. Criticism is the art that contends against them for their own benefit, and also to further its own aesthetic ends, to make its articulate noise in the world. This means that criticism, far from being a minor, petty, secondary art, is in fact larger than the others. There is more of it. Its scope is wider, its methods more eclectic than any of its rivals. It encompasses all of them and compels them all to serve its needs. It is not parasitic, but primary. I know what this sounds like. Sophistry, vain hyperbole, sheer arrogant nonsense. In the sense that Mencken understood and practiced it, criticism is a relatively new and limited pursuit. And throughout human history, a great many artistic traditions have flourished entirely untouched by what we or Mencken would identify as criticism. No cartouche has been unearthed suggesting the existence of an Egyptian sage urging the public not to miss the pyramids. They were even harder to miss then than they are now. Scribes and calligraphers in the ages before newspapers and magazines did not have the time or inclination to jot down and copy responses to the latest madrigal or altarpiece. Wandering through museum galleries, we can be moved and delighted by African masks, Greek vases, and Chinese scrolls without knowing, in some cases without even being able to guess, what contemporary local savants might have made of them. But we can also be sure that these objects and experiences did not make their way to us without passing through a process of judgmental scrutiny that began at the moment of their conception, and that informed every stage of their gestation. Every made thing answers to, which is also to say that it struggles against and sometimes transcends, aesthetic norms and cultural purposes that are implicit within it, even as they may be inscrutable to late-arriving or alien eyes. A work of art is itself a piece of criticism. The purpose of George Steiner's thought experiment, his peremptory sweeping away of the fog of commentary that he sees shrouding the finest products of the human imagination, is to clarify exactly this point. All serious art, music, and literature, he writes, is a critical act. By which he means not only that art in general constitutes a criticism of life, in Matthew Arnold's phrase, but also that the arts embody an expository reflection on, a value judgment of, the inheritance and context to which they pertain. This is a starchy, pseudo-Germanic way of noting that, far from existing in a state of serene, autotelic isolation, works of art reach beyond themselves, engaging other works that exist alongside and before them and the historical circumstances in which they arise. On one level, the point is so obvious that it hardly needs arguing. Libraries, course syllabi, museums, and the iTunes store are all organized around a belief in the organic existence of genres, traditions, periods, and other forms of artistic affiliation. We are routinely taught to attend to context, an agreeably vague term for the stuff we might want to know about the thing we are looking at, and also, more precisely, for the stuff that thing seems to know. We may still cling to the myth of the solitary creator, toiling in a garret awaiting a visit from the muse, but the reality of creation has always been much more interactive. Not simply because an individual painter or writer is likely, however cantankerously or reluctantly, to be part of a scene or a school, or even because of the essentially collaborative, collective nature of pursuits like theater, film, architecture, and music. All art that is recognizable as such is in some degree about other art. Every writer is a reader, every musician a listener, driven by a desire to imitate, to correct, to improve, or to answer the models before them. It would be too much to say that every artist is a failed critic, unable to appreciate what already exists without adding to it, but it does not seem to me inaccurate to say that all art is successful criticism. This is a simple, practical observation, but I also want to gesture toward what I take to be a vaster and more fundamental truth. We are accustomed in the post-everything present to an aesthetic of the sample, the mashup, and the pastiche. For several decades now, an era marked by hip-hop appropriation, self-ironizing television shows, literary parody, and cinematic homage, culture has thrived on various styles of borrowing, quotation, and meta-commentary, much of it bracingly original. At worst, we have been subjected to tiresome and cynical bouts of remaking and recycling. But what is more striking is the sheer novelty that so often emerges from the contemplation and reinvention of the old. Hip-hop is perhaps the supreme example of this apparent paradox. An authentically and at times radically new musical idiom built from the stolen beats and blended sounds of antecedent forms. Similar practices of nodding and winking, spoofing and honoring, remixing and repurposing have a way of popping up wherever our gazes happen to land. Filmmakers like Quentin Tarantino and Joel and Ethan Coen, to cite only two of the better-known cases, mine the movie past to make films that are saturated in history without quite resembling anything that has come before. Visual art since the 1980s, when Andy Warhol replaced Jackson Pollock as the supreme influence on the young, has aggressively recombined both the iconography and the literal images of earlier times. 100 hothouse flowers have bloomed. Paintings based on paintings, photographs of photographs, photographs of paintings, and hard-to-classify, hard-to-miss artifacts that count as works of art because no other category exists for them. Not everyone is happy about this, of course. There is by now a bursting archive of complaint about the derivative, secondary, unserious aspects, not just of particular works or artists, but of entire art forms, and of the hectically self-conscious, air-quoting zeitgeist itself. The situation that Steiner calls our current misère, which to a sensibility less saturnine might look like a whole world of fun, is often faulted for the ascendancy of hybrids, simulacra, and imitations, secondhand stuff that has crowded out the authentic, heroic, self-authorized masterpieces of yesteryear. But whatever you think about specific trends and tendencies within late 20th century and early 21st century culture, what used to be called postmodernism and is now just called now, they represent the latest iteration of something as old as art itself. Imitation is not the erosion of originality. It is the condition of originality. History proves as much. The popular culture of the past half century has been a self-propelling machine for the production of novelty that turns almost instantly into nostalgia. An old song is one that was on the radio two summers ago. A classic is the one you dance to at your prom. And the movies and television programs of your childhood are marked with the tints and timbres of antiquarianism. But the thread that connects the generations is a relentless dialectic of copying and reinvention. Every explosion of transformative newness turns out, on closer inspection, to be the recovery and recasting of what was already there, aided by new technology and the eager devotion of fans striving to pay tribute to their idols by mimicking and surpassing them. The story of rock and roll is a chronicle of successive generations of teenagers teaching themselves Chuck Berry riffs and going from there. As soon as the style grows too big or baroque, as soon as the raw essence of the music is obscured by commercial scale or artistic ambition, someone will come along to give the wheel another turn by reinventing it. The iconoclasts of the French New Wave were enthralled to the artistry of Hollywood studio hacks, auteurs, in other words, and bewitched by the power of American commercial genres. Jean-Luc Godard's Breathless is a movie without precedent, full of freshness, youthful vigor, and the air of Parisian post-war reality. And yet it is also almost entirely a commentary on American crime cinema going back to the 1930s. And, in turn, quite a lot of the most interesting subsequent cinema, from Bonnie and Clyde to Wong Kar-wai, is a commentary on and elaboration of the themes and styles of Breathless. Godard is an exceptional figure, of course, but also, for just that reason, an exemplary one. There has perhaps never been a filmmaker so completely and compulsively obsessed with cinema, as a record of history, a tool for thought, a playpen, and a field of battle. Godard is also a director for whom filmmaking and film criticism are finally indistinguishable. To say that the polemical and appreciative essays he wrote in Cahiers as a young man, in which he embraced with militant fervor the movies of Howard Hawks, Fritz Lang, Nicholas Ray, and other misunderstood geniuses of the studio system, were a prelude to the investigations of cinematic form carried out in Breathless and beyond, is also to say that those films carried out, by other means, the investigations begun in print. In his late work, above all, the 8-part, 4.5-hour-long Histoire du cinéma, this continuity becomes explicit, as the sequence of moving images becomes the ideal medium for thinking about the legacy and the future of motion pictures. Godard's Histoire is a grand anomaly, and also the apotheosis of a familiar genre, the movie about movies. Cinema is a language with built-in reflexive capabilities that other art forms may seem to lack. Music criticism is unlikely to be scored, or art criticism conducted by means of brush and pigment. But it is precisely in those art forms that Godard's epic collage, a counterpoint of borrowed images and meditative narration, finds its strongest precedence. The canon of high literature, fine art, and classical music consists of a long conversation between eras, styles, and nations that is at times covert rather than explicit. But that is always there. Some of the principal monuments of literary modernism, James Joyce's Ulysses, Ezra Pound's Cantos, Eliot's The Wasteland, are brand new tapestries woven out of ancient thread. And some of the most radical innovations of the 19th and 20th century avant-garde are acts of recovery and reinterpretation. Pound's exhortation to make it new, an enduring and perennially refreshable modernist slogan, presumes the existence of that all-important it, which is to say everything that the frigate of human civilization has left in its wake. The new does not occur in a vacuum. It requires materials, and the revolutionary impulse that swept in successive waves across the arts from the middle of the 19th century to the middle of the 20th involved the compulsive excavation of such materials for rescue, correction, and adaptation. Manet, the first great modern painter, may have been responding to the social tumult of Paris in the 1860s and 70s. But he was also conducting a passionate argument with Titian and Velázquez, and the tradition of European painting, attempting to recover the sources of its vitality and give them currency in his own changed milieu. Picasso, coming a little more than a generation after Manet, began his career with an intensive inquiry into his native tradition, evoking Goya, Velázquez, El Greco, and other Spanish masters in his early paintings. As his ambition grew, he radically expanded his field of influences to include, most decisively, the African masks and figures that inspired Les Demoiselles d'Avignon and the Greek vase decorations that informed his mischievously erotic late drawings and etchings. His intent was not to quote or to appropriate, or to flatter the cleverness of beholders who might get the references, but rather to find a vocabulary of images and techniques.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.